tell all your friends about me.
What are you?
I'm Batman.
It's not college basketball. It's Clarence
time! Let's get ready to rumble! Feel the fires into the rear. It's nice and only know how to wear.
Welcome back, guys. It is just another Friday night, and in fact it is Friday night, and it's just another one of these Friday nights, and you are here with me, CM Chuck, and alongside me, the best co-host in the business, Double A Adamantium Adam. Let him know what time it is, brother.
Guys, it's podcasting time.
Woo-hoo! Guys, if you caught the Facebook Live pre-show, then you know we're going to get right into a story that we just finished. It's a current story, so it's really cool for us to get to it. But the man of a thousand laughs, ooh, the man with the guys, the Joker just wrapped up a three-issue story, right, Double A?
Yes.
Called Three Jokers. Batman, mm-hmm. Three Jokers. Mm-hmm. Written by Geoff Johns. I was going to call him Geoff.
Yeah, superstar Geoff Johns, yes.
But it's spelled Geoff.
First off, how did you feel about his writing?
Great.
Because he's the one that really made me a Green Lantern fan. It was because of his writing.
Yeah, and I know that Friday Nighter, Albert Olivares, who did our music, is also a huge. He's always told me that about him, that Geoff Johns. And he's got like a high position now in DC, right?
Yes, he does. Yes, he's president, I believe.
No shit.
Yes, wow. I think he is. So
I love when a writer's getting the bag, y'all. That's pretty cool. But I loved it. Actually, it made me want to. So part of the reason why I would read the Green Lantern run, because you guys say it's so great, and that Blackest Night stuff sounded really cool. So I mean, I'm not closed to checking it out. It's just that Green Lantern isn't like one of my guys.
I know.
So it's kind of like, you know,
wasn't one of mine either. So
okay, Geoff Johns, okay, totally. Okay. Yes. And now would you say it's one of your guys?
Yes.
Okay. So that's powerful writing.
He connects things that kind of like writers left wide open that you just didn't understand. Oh. And I feel like that's what he did here. I feel like he connected a lot of webs with this Three Jokers story that he connected from this story. He connected from this story and he connected from this story. Mm-hmm. And he made it all work in this Three mm-hmm. Jokers story. So as soon as he was listed as a writer, I was like, okay, you already sold me on that one.
Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah,
and his superstardom is not that I can't deny, because I know without having read Blackest Night or any of that stuff, I know of it, and I also obviously knew his name and know that he's got a high position there at DC. So but I was excited mainly to read this because it's like I like the Joker and I like Batman.
Who doesn't?
I mean, as we sit here, guys, I'm rocking my Alex Ross villain shirt. And it's funny, we talked about this in our pre-show, and then we talked about it also in between recording that and this, how right up front is the man. Yep. You know what I mean? They put the Joker up front, Lex.
You got Bizarro, you got Brainiac, you got Luthor, you got Black Adam, you got Scarecrow, you got Riddler, you got Gorilla Grodd, you got all these fucking big-time Sinestro's here too. You got all these big villains, and Joker is right in front.
Cheetah too.
Cheetah's there on the side. Yeah. And he's right in front.
And it would be like, if you think of DC and you think of their top guy, you think of Superman, and you think maybe Superman's top villain is DC's top villain. Wrong. And a lot of people will argue with us and say that Batman is the top guy.
Yeah.
Maybe sales wise. Sales and merch, maybe. I mean, but either way, there's no doubt who the top villain in DC is.
I mean, his movie on just about him.
Double A, is there another villain that got a solo film?
That's I can't think of
unheard of, I think. And in fact, when I heard that, I was like, wow, really? They're going all in. And I was like, people didn't know what to expect. And the man walks away with an Oscar.
CM, we're not most people. We kind of knew what to expect.
Yeah.
And we got there opening night. At least I did. Me and my brother went opening night.
I literally could not wait. I was playing the trailer over and over. I loved that smile trailer so much.
Yes. So we were there. Yeah. And we fucking loved it. Yeah. So it's just, there's something about the Joker, that for some reason Batman can just, he cannot get the Joker. He can solve everyone else. He can solve Joker's riddles. He can solve Penguin. He can
Riddler's riddles. But yeah, I got you.
Uh-huh. He can solve Two-Face. He can solve everybody. The Joker is so fucking unpredictable because he has no plan. Mm-hmm. There is no plan to his madness. He's just mad. He just does things.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just, it's like Heath Ledger's Joker said, you know, I'm just like a dog chasing after a car. I wouldn't know what to do with it after I caught it. You know, it's I don't know. He's just so fucking psycho, so crazy. Batman, there's nothing Batman can do that can put intimidation in him. Nothing.
No, that doesn't work. You know, nothing. Batman wears the cap, the cape and cowl to strike fear. This is this is a guy without fear, though, where fear is probably like a foreign concept.
Yeah, I don't even know if he knows fear.
I wonder if Scarecrow used fear toxin on
Joker. It does not work.
Does not work.
Poison Ivy's poisons does not work on him. Scarecrow.
It's insane.
It doesn't. Insane. Exactly. You hit it right there. It's insane.
I always love when we're doing an episode, AA, and I can look over one of your shoulders and I can see it. And right now I'm looking at his face with the other two anarchists.
So I have this poster somebody made. I bought it like 10 years ago. It's a picture of Alex Delarge from Clockwork. Mm-hmm. In the middle is the Heath Ledger Joker. Mm-hmm. And on the far left, it's Tyler Durden from Fight Club. They're all known for one thing. That's being anarchists, being very unpredictable. Chaos. And they're all put in one image. Like if they're one You're seeing like
the three faces. That's a great print, man. I would love to own that too. I need to get that because I love all three of those movies deeply.
Yeah, I bought that for my wife. She just fell in love with it.
It's really awesome. Yeah,
because Fight Club, like you, is like one of her top five movies.
Yeah, that's so, I was actually redoing my top five after our conversation last weekend.
Oh, okay.
And I was like, yeah, it's still there because I love that. The concepts of that.
And then me and her did dress up like Clockwork 1 year.
Yeah,
and
that's right. You know, that's great.
She just loved up until Joaquin Phoenix. Heath Ledger was her favorite Joker. Okay. Now it's Joaquin Phoenix.
Yeah. Well, I mean, the man did a great job.
Yeah.
But let's get right back to it, Dolly. So before we get right into through Jokers, let's get a little background. You did mention that there are other stories that Geoff Johns took from. So should we go back before?
Okay. Yeah. So, first off, you want to do stories first or you want to kind of like what?
Let me take Death in the Family.
Okay,
and I'll go a little bit there, guys. So back in the day in the 80s, there was a story called Death in the Family. It made major news. Newsweek magazine did a thing on it. And pretty much, guys, it was a four-issue arc by, I believe...
It's Jim Starlin.
Beautiful art by... And, guys, when you look at this, you're getting the...
I'm sorry.
I got it right here, too.
Yeah. Starlin is a writer. Jim Aparo.
Right.
I'm sorry if I'm getting that wrong. And Mike DiCarlo. We have heard of his name a few times here and there.
Yeah.
He's an inker. Danny O'Neill was the editor.
Oh, that's
He's the one that kind of really took a lot of the heat for what happened in this story.
Guys, let me read you. I want to read this. It says the comics event, news event of the year. I'm going to read you just the back cover of my trade paperback here. This is actually my first trade paperback I ever owned. My dad bought it for me. Years and years ago, and it's so beat. AA's in here, okay, but the inside is so good. You still read it. It's good. It's awesome. Let me read when this was printed here. 1988. Cool. So I would have been seven. Cool. You know what I mean? So I don't think my dad bought it from me right then, but I remember seeing the cover, thought it was so cool. I wanted to know what happened, guys, is A Death in the Family is about Robin dying. Now, it's not Dick Grayson Robin. It is the second Robin, Jason Todd.
Yeah, so Dick Grayson has already moved on. Mm-hmm. He's become Nightwing. He's with the Teen Titans. He's that. So Batman needs another sidekick.
Ward. It says here on the back, the comics news event of the year. Here's some of the quotes. Readers clearly regarded the new Robin as a whining usurper and decided on capital punishment. Time Magazine. But the real murderers are the Batman readers. Newsweek. A group of comic book artists and writers has succeeded in doing what most fiendish minds, a group of comic book writers and artists succeeded in doing what the most fiendish minds of the century have failed to accomplish. That's from Reuters. Holy Ayatollah, Batman, Robin is dead, The Wall Street Journal. The Boy Wonder is dead, and the readers of DC Comics Batman want it that way, USA Today. Coming this month is a whole new way of doing a book, and you'll see it first from DC with the Batman series, the Boston Rock. it would be a really sleazy stunt to bring him back. Denny O'Neill, editor of Batman Comics. Well, Denny O'Neill, rest in peace. Denny O'Neill. Rest in peace, sir. The sleaze was in the fix, guys, because let me tell you what happens briefly before we get to that. You're going to find out. Long story short, Joker's up to no good, wants to steal some missiles, becomes an ambassador in Saudi Arabia.
Let me cut you off a little bit.
No, go ahead.
So it kind of has a little descriptive right here. So in the first issue of book one, Robin, Jason Todd, begins a quest for his identity. His mother awaits him somewhere in the Middle East, but sudden and violent death is also waiting for him. And the most tragic secret of all, will the Batman be on time? So it sounds like this was pretty much he was looking for his mother. In issue two, it looks like he finds his mother, but also waiting is the Joker planning a revenge that is swift, violent, and terrible. Mm-hmm. So in this story, he was looking for his mother. I guess he finds her somewhere in the Middle East, and he also runs into the Joker.
Yeah.
Jason Todd was not a very popular character, from what I gather. Not very popular, Robin.
No.
Very attitude, he talks back a lot. Was not like Dick Grayson whatsoever. Just very headstrong, very unpopular. Go ahead, Tim. So that's why I wanted to
say. No. I mean, guys, and pretty much what happens is that, the Joker lures Robin to this warehouse and ties him to a chair, guys. And you might think that he's going to use Joker poison, Joker fish, acid, or Joker something. Smiling something, acid flower. You'd be way wrong. The Joker takes a crowbar and proceeds to beat Robin, Jason Todd Robin, to death.
It's violent. It's brutal.
Very violent.
It's ugly.
Very violent. Very ugly. I mean, one of the most startling moments
in comic books.
That I think I'd ever seen. And yeah, the book starts out with, them, Batman and Robin, going at it, fighting crime, trying to...
Do you think it's just going to be another, Batman adventure?
Right. But you'd be way wrong. And the Joker just has him at every turn. Mm-hmm. He's got goons. They beat him. They help beat him down. Once they beat him down, they tie him up. And then he goes to work with the crowbar. And Jason Todd's mother is there. And he tries to get involved. And she tries to get involved, but to no avail. And I mean, that's pretty much it. The goons set bombs in the warehouse. Batman's on the way. You think that he's already dead, but he does get up, manages to save the mom. He unties her. She tries to help him. And they almost get out, but they're too late. And it blows up the warehouse. And the next thing you know, you've got Batman running there. Batman being too late, looking for him. And he's remembering, training him and all that. He's looking through the rubble, and he's just like pretty much already cursing himself, like, what the hell happened? What's going on? And he finds the mom. She dies in Batman's arms. And then he continues to dig the rubble, and then he finds the body. And you see, guys, this is like the Robin, that you would see, like the Burt Ward Robin with the little Robin booties in the trunks, the green trunks. And he's just there. He clutches the body.
Yeah.
And then the infamous scene that's the cover of the trade.
Yes.
Him carrying the broken,
lifeless,
one
broken
foot,
body.
one shoe on, and just dead fucking meat, guys. Superman comes out in this book later on. Superman shows up later on in the book. Trying to, kind of console Bats.
He has to, and then he's also there for as a protection for Joker, too.
Yeah, right? Well, because the Joker has managed to get himself diplomatic immunity, and Batman is, not having it, and Superman's like, buddy, you can't just do what you want, you know what I mean? But Batman being Batman, takes a swing at him, and, of course, hurts his fucking hand. To which Superman tells him, you could have broken every bone in your hand. I rolled with it or whatever. What I mean? Because in the image, it looks like he takes it or whatever. He hit him. But then you see Batman just gripping his hand like, oh, fuck. my hand is, trashed, which it is. And,
So So that's a very big issue. Mm-hmm.
It's huge.
Huge Batman story. And it fits very heavily into this three Joker story.
Exactly. Line. Exactly.
So a few years prior to this, you know, they introduce Jason Todd. They mm-hmm. bring him back.
He comes back, guys. Yeah.
So that's what I want to get. So he was dead. He was one of those, just like Bucky, where you thought he was a character that was going to just stay dead. Mm-hmm. He did not. Mm-hmm. They brought him back as a Red Hood. So that's that kind of story. So that's that story. What other story do we get that kind of draw that three Jokers draws from?
If you want to know why Jason Todd returns and calls himself the Red Hood, you've got to go to one of the most iconic Batman stories ever written.
Yes.
By Alan Moore and Brian Bolland is the artist. Mm-hmm. And it is called The Killing Joke.
Yeah.
You've heard it over and over again. There's an animated version. It is very different. Guys, this is like, what was this? A single issue, double A?
I mean, yes, like, it was. It was just a graphic. It was supposed to be non-canon, CM, because, you know, it was supposed to give an origin to the Joker, but DC really weren't, like, you know, they didn't want Joker to have, like, an origin.
Right.
But this was just something that they asked, I guess, Alan Moore to do. He does it, and it becomes just an absolute classic, yes, with that famous image where he comes out with his hands in his hair, his fucking skin is bleached, his hair is dark green, everything.
This image, they use, I think they use this.
They use it for so many
t-shirts. Yes. I mean,
it's so classic. So in this story, they give Joker a background where he is an engineer in chemicals, but he's also wants to be a stand-up comedian. Yeah. He is a poor comedian. He does not get through, almost like the Joker Joaquin Phoenix one. They draw very heavily on this story as well.
Yeah.
He has a pregnant wife.
That's a different element,
which is something different. Phoenix he actually has a family.
Yeah.
They're hurting bad financially. This is kind of like when Batman's young too. Kind of just starting out too
himself. Maybe like a year one,
maybe,
almost. Batman,
maybe.
Yeah.
So this is a story where he really tries to get into Batman's head. Yeah. And he hurts Barbara Gordon bad.
Real bad, guys.
Bad. She becomes paralyzed for like a good number of years.
Now, is she Batgirl already?
Yes, she is.
She's already Batgirl.
Yes,
okay.
She is.
And so
he's trying to push Batman. And the way he thinks he can do it is by hurting Batgirl and torturing Jim Gordon, his most trusted friend that Batman has. And it's brutal. He's torturing Barbara. He's making Jim Gordon look at the torture.
Yeah.
He's trying to push Gordon. He's trying to push Batman to that one bad day. That one bad day that anyone can have where all they need is just an extra push to become as crazy as he does.
Yeah. Yeah, this is dark, guys.
Very dark.
The scene is classic. And if you watched our pre-show, we showed you some of the three Jokers covers. And we're going to recap them in our throughout the week as we promote our episodes.
Yes.
But it just there's no words on this page I'm looking at right now. And you just see him with the Joker's got the brim of his hat. And Barbara looks
at him. He's dressed like he's going to Hawaii.
Yeah. You know, he's got a camera there, which is very famously on the cover.
Somehow
there.
He finds out who she is. Mm-hmm. He goes to her house. He shoots her.
Right in the abdomen, guys.
It goes through her spine.
Mm-hmm.
And
Gordon's sitting right there. He jumps up and he's like freaking out. And Joker pours himself a drink.
Yeah.
He's got some hooch
here.
Sure.
Yeah. Yeah.
And she's crying. Yeah, and I mean, these guys are They're beating him. He's got some goons with him.
Yes, he does.
They knock his ass out.
It's always weird, right? How he always has goons with him.
Oh yeah, yeah. I don't
like,
know
who
why
the fuck
they
would follow him.
I think he must pay well.
I guess
must pay well because they're there. You know
yeah,
what I, mean?
I guess. It's a really brutal issue, and it flashes back to when he's like the Joker, when he's doing a Barbara, Jim, and Batman, and then back to when he's a failed comedian that ends up becoming this Red Hood. You know, just a figure, just a criminal figure, nothing really important. He's just trying to have money so he can support his wife and his unborn child.
Right, right.
He first encounters Batman there, and then that's when he drops into the vat. of chemicals. That's right,
exactly.
And it's kind of like, oh, shit. I mean, he was already twisted. He's already going that direction because he had found out his wife got killed by an electrocution death. Right, Sam?
Yep, that's what they tell him.
And that's when he just, you know, this was kind of like the already just that bad day. He got pushed.
Yeah, he falls in with some mafiosos. Yes. They're kind of the ones who tell him to kind of wear the red hood too. Yeah. And I mean, throughout this, guys, he's flashing back and forth, and he's parading around a nude Jim Gordon in the rain in a funhouse, leather, like a leather dog collar. Like, guys, this shit is fucked up.
It is.
Like, you're like, what in the fuck? And like, he's showing nude images of Barbara to Gordon throughout. Pretty much trying to crack him. And again, all this is his way of getting to Batman.
To Batman. He doesn't care about Gordon. He doesn't care about Barbara. He just wants to break Batman.
Yeah. And it's like he's like going the long way around by like hurt the daughter, hurt the dad, and now hurt this man.
Yes.
You know, so I mean, guys, truly, we could go a whole issue on the Killing Joke. And it's, you know, the book itself and then the movie version of it, which may down the line we may do that. But we just want to give you a little bit enough to know how it leads in. So you've got this family. He's been told that they're dead.
Yeah.
The wife and the son. And then I believe it pushes him further into madness. It does,
where he finally just takes that offer from the mafia.
They say it was an electrocution accident.
It was.
Yeah.
And he takes his offer from the mafia. He becomes a Red Hood. He encounters Batman. He gets soaked into that vat of chemicals. He comes out with that famous image, fucking psycho.
Boom.
Becomes the Joker.
Yeah. And you're led to believe that this is the origin story. But again,
but you also get the connection of why Batgirl is an important character in the three Jokers, why Jim Gordon is an important character, why Jason Todd. These two stories are heavily borrowed from in the three Jokers storyline. All the history. Really, I would say read Death in the Family and Killing Joke before you started Three Jokers.
Yeah.
These are probably the ones that you would get the most input from and how it connects.
Yeah, and they're awesome and great to read anyway on their own.
Well written, beautifully drawn. Yes. All three stories, beautifully drawn.
Classic Batman with the blue suit and the gray, and like the Joker looks fucking incredible and all of
Psycho.
And of course Alan Moore, any of his writing is
top notch,
not to be trifled with. I mean the man is easily one of the top comic book writers of all time
in the 80s, top writer period. In the 80s I would have said there's probably no one better than Batman.
Right, took on Batman, Swamp Thing, League of Extraordinary Gentlemen,
Superman too.
Guys,
he wrote the last Superman story as well before Crisis on Infinite Earth.
Stuff they've made movies out of that belong to Alan Moore are Watchmen, guys, because he wrote that. From Hell, V for Vendetta,
League of Extraordinary Gentlemen.
Yeah. Now, mind you, if he didn't like any of those, he also disowns them because the books are very different.
He disowns them, but they borrow heavily from his writing.
Yes. So check those out, guys. But AA, if there was one other story you needed to read right before reading this, and you don't need to, guys. You can read this on its own and get it, and it's good. It does a great job. But if you wanted to, you could read. There was a story called The Dark Side War, right?
Oh, yes. No.
Go into that one.
There's this also one shot called Just Joker by Brian Azzarello, art by Lee
Bermejo.
Joker somehow gets out of Arkham.
Yes.
But this is a different Joker. This isn't kind of like the crazy Joker that you see in Death and Family or what he becomes in Killing Joke. This is like a criminal mastermind that interacts with Penguin, that interacts with Two-Face.
A real gangster.
Yeah. Underworld is really afraid of this dude. So he is very heavily featured in the three Jokers as well. This Joker. I would recommend Death and Family, Joker, and Killing Joke to start before you read Three Jokers.
Yeah.
Okay, and then like a few years ago, Geoff Johns did. It was a big, massive crossover.
DC event.
The Dark Side War. After it was over, Batman finds his chair. It's called the Mobius chair. Mm-hmm. It's supposed to be one of DC's like big. It's not a weapon, but like one of the, I guess, the universal a universal weapon.
Yeah, like but if it's you're, not a if weapon. You're, if you're thinking of the Marvel Universe, maybe like one of the things you see that becomes an Infinity Stone, like the Cosmic Cube
or
the
Ether. Like something like that. That's what this Mobius chair is. And it has knowledge. It has all the knowledge of the universe. Batman gets a chance to sit on it, and you know, he tests it. One of the things he asks is because he's not too sure. You know, he's just human. He goes, "Who killed my parents?" Mm-hmm. It tells him Joe Chill. Mm-hmm. Okay. All right. Cool. So you know, even me, you know who killed my parents.
Because he knew that, but he wanted to test.
He wanted to see if it really didn't know.
Right.
All right. So, okay. So the next question he asks is, what is Joker's real name?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Which has always been like a big old mystery. No one knows Joker's name.
Yeah.
No one knows his origin. Mystery.
Yeah.
Nothing. Next page has him. He goes, no, it can't be.
Right.
Right. Right. So we're kind of left with a cliffhanger.
Mm-hmm.
And then he reveals it later on saying, you know, the Mobius chair told me there's three Jokers. And it's got images of all the Jokers throughout the decades.
Yeah.
And they're telling him that there's three Jokers. So he's been fighting three Jokers this whole time. Not just one. There's three of them.
Because, guys, if you know the Joker, you know that there's always been kind of like different aspects and elements to him. You
always.
Know? You know, yeah. There's the one gaggy Joker with like the Joker fish and the acid flower. You know,
there's the mobster Joker. There's the anarchist Joker.
Right.
There's the clown prince of crime Joker. There's the murderer Joker. You know, you got all these Jokers, and you can even see in the movie, Sam.
Oh, yeah.
There's so many. Yeah. They all play different kinds of Jokers.
Jack Nicholson, very different.
You had the Cesar Romero. Yeah. He was the very comedic one.
Yes.
You had the Jack Nicholson was a mobster.
Very mob.
You had the Heath Ledger, the anarchist. You have Jared Leto, was kind of like the underworld Joker,
right?
You have the Joaquin Phoenix, the film comedian Joker.
Yes.
You have all these different kinds of Jokers, and you're just like, who the hell is this guy? Yeah.
And the reason you can get these different types of Jokers in these different movies and different incarnations, guys, is because that's how random and different the Joker acts. Yes. So is it really a stretch to believe that it was more than one guy?
More than one.
You know what I mean? Some people are like, what? No, that's whack. Like, I don't want there to be three. But you're like, think about how different they are. Think about how different they act.
I'm not going to lie to you. I was kind of like that myself.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not going to lie. I was like, three Jokers? Okay, now you're
just ruining it. Yeah, you're fucking with our shit. You know?
Yeah. Okay, so we get down to the characters. We get down to issue one. And, you know, we get Batman. We get Jason Todd, who's been resurrected.
Yeah.
Or didn't actually die. He was left in a shallow grave. Somehow he picked himself up, but he's kind of twisted now.
Mm-hmm.
And he goes by the Red Hood, which was, if you were at the Killing Joke, that's what the Joker was before he became the Joker.
So he's taken this name.
He adopts that.
Yeah.
Then you have Batgirl. She's walking. Somewhere along the way between the Killing Joke and this story, I don't know. I guess they found a way that she could.
Yeah.
They fix her spine.
That's right.
Okay.
She's better.
The first couple of issues, the pages are pretty brutal. You get Batman kind of entering the Batcave, and he's fucked up. He's badly fucked up. And it's a great team. He goes straight to Alfred. Alfred already knows what to do. He gets the instruments. He starts cutting his costume.
Mm-hmm.
You see all the fucking scars on Batman's back. And it's cool because it kind of shows what the bad guys did. Like he has a penguin's umbrella stabbing him, and it shows a mark. It has Killer Croc biting him on his arm, and it still has like the bites.
Yeah.
It has like Joker's acid, and he has like the acid burn. He's got like Riddler's like fucking stick that like I guess like burned him to
question mark.
Yeah, he's got Catwoman's cuts on his chest that he still has. I mean, it's brutal. It's a cool few pages where all the villains, you know, where Bane has broke his back and his back's kind of like fucked up. It's a really cool amount of pages.
Let me tell you this real quick, guys. I don't mean to interrupt you.
No, go ahead.
The art here by Jason Fabok, I hope I'm saying that right, Fabok, is gorgeous,
yes.
Number one.
Yes.
And right away, you can get me in a book with great art because that will like really,
yeah. me and CM are very big on the art. If the art sucks, it's kind of hard for us to read it.
It is. We talked about this when I read, you know, the truth story, mm-hmm. the Captain America, when the art was like, it was a good story, but it could have been better with better art. And I want to tell you more about this art, guys. But first, let me take a quick break, and then we're going to get right into issue one of the three Jokers.
You are about to participate in the most ambitious culinary experiment ever imagined.
This competition is going to test everything.
Adapt quickly to anything. I mean anything. The wildest day of your life starts right now.
All new 24 and 24 Last Chef Standing. Sunday night at 8 on Food Network. Stream on Max.
And we are back, guys, after a little laugh, a little Joker fish. And we're talking all things the three Jokers.
Yes.
And we're right, maybe smack dab in the middle of the issue one.
Issue one, yeah.
We've already talked about that we saw Batman brutalized and that it shows the various villains kind of going at him.
Yeah.
And then you get this great three pages, right, AA, where it's telling a story with just images. Mm-hmm. Everyone's kind of hurt Batman in their own little way. Croc, Scarecrow, you know. But then you see 1, 2, 3 images of one specific guy hurting him. Mm-hmm. And that guy is the Joker. And it's
with
almost
acid,
like,
shit, with a razor blade.
Really four, because on the one before, too. It's almost the story it's telling you guys is, I've been hurt by a lot of people, but no one's hurt me more than you.
Than
you
him.
Know?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And gosh damn it, the art is so beautiful, man. Like, this is like your consummate Bruce Wayne.
It's great. It's so very detailed.
Yeah, and it's lovely too that there's so many flashback scenes, because it's kind of getting to see these old scenes recaptured. And mm-hmm. I mean, guys, right back to the theater where Bruce is at with his parents, Thomas Wayne. You know, all that, the alleyway. Guys, I mean, you know this story or whatever, but it's there. And then you go right from there to seeing...
Real quick.
Go ahead,
it's like
in between that scene,
you're hearing reports that there's been a Joker killing here. But at the same time, there's been a Joker killing. And at the same time, there's been another Joker killing. All at the same time.
Right.
And, you know, you're hearing reports and you're just like, what the hell?
Yeah.
Joker... at three spots at one time, killing people. He's killed some mobsters in one part. He's killed like a comedian, a Hawaiian comedian actor in another part. You know, and then that's when you kind of flash forward to Barbara. Now, Barbara Gordon.
Yes.
She's on a treadmill. She's at a gym.
She looks hot.
Yeah. Yeah, and now it's like they're showing her. She's bathing after, you know, breaking a treadmill again.
Yeah.
Her bullet wounds.
Yeah, that specific wound, guys. What did we tell you about happened in The Killing Joke, guys? Go read it. Go read it. Look at
even
it.
Even with the drink that you said, too, after he shoots
having
her.
A fucking drink. Right below her belly button, I mean, and drawn so excellently by Jason Fabok again. I cannot get over how gorgeous the art is. But, yeah, I mean, it's like she's remembering, too. She's hearing – is she hearing the crime reports as well?
She is hearing it, too, at the same time as Bruce. And then after that whole scene of her remembering with Jason Todd, who is in his red hood form.
Yeah.
He is
just look cool, guys. I think it looks cool. It's kind of
it's fine.
In the Killing Joke, you know, Joker wears this kind of like a big like cylinder type of like a what would you call it?
It's like a cylinder almost.
Yeah, like a cylinder, but rounded at the top. Yeah. And that's what he has. But Jason Todd kind of makes it like a cooler, like a motorcycle mask type.
Yeah.
You know, like a
It's high tech too.
Yeah, it's neat. You know? Yeah, it's got like tech
so
in it.
It, can do it doesn't look as bad or stupid as
the
one that the Joker.
Right.
I think even in The Killing Joke, he's like, man, he can't see. You know.
Yeah, exactly. He says
so
that,
Jason Todd is like brutalizing some Joker.
He's fucking them up. Joker thugs. You can tell they're Joker thugs, so they got tats on them.
They
Joker
got tats
and DJ on their
and
face.
They're like at a cemetery, and reports are still coming in. Of all these murders that the Joker's doing.
And he wants info, right? He was trying to get some intel.
Yes. Well, somebody manages to get his hood off. You see his scars on his head that he has. And it flashes back to when the Joker is just brutalizing him with the crowbar. With the
fucking crowbar, yeah.
And after he snaps out of it, that's when he gets back at the thugs. He beats them up mercilessly.
Yeah.
Just trying to find information on the Joker. And then that's when we get to the crime scenes.
Yes. And what's neat about Jason Todd, too, is I was telling Double A this in our little break, is that even when you knock the Red Hood hood off him, he still wears the Robin, like he's the Robin mask over his eyes. It's almost like a little tribute to himself.
Almost.
We kind of get more into his psychology later. But
yeah, because he's really broken.
Literally and physically, it seems like.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we get to the crime scene, Double A, and what's going on?
So again, they're hearing these reports of the Joker, and the, you know, Bullock and Gordon are kind of going back and forth. They're like, what the hell's going on? And Batman shows up.
Your classic Gotham detectives right there.
Yeah, and they're at the chemical spot, the Ace Chemicals,
mm-hmm.
where Joker was born. Mm-hmm. And Batman doesn't believe it's Joker, okay? But he knows there's something, you know, obviously this is Joker. One of the victims kind of comes alive. You know, but he's just crazy.
Yeah.
If you're infected with this Joker poison,
toxin,
you kind of have to try and stay the best you can calm.
Yeah.
Calm as best you can, or else it's going to kill you. The Batgirl, Batman are, you know, they're trying to, you know, make sure the patient gets there fine. Jason Todd somehow gets into the ambulance. He brutalizes this poor dude that's a victim,
mm-hmm.
you know. Batman has to kind of stop him from killing him because he's like gleaning information. You know, again, Jason Todd just does not like Bruce Wayne. He does not like Batman. He blames him for everything that's happened to him. And, you know, it's a big scuffle.
You know,
big old scuffle.
Right.
Then you get another shot of Joker driving like a big rig of the Ace Chemicals. And he's going to like this woods. It's like in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
To this one little house. And he knocks on the door, and the Joker answers the door. So the Joker knocks on the door, and the Joker answers it. So now we got two Jokers that you're seeing in the flesh, you know, and you're just like, what the fuck's going on? You know? And then that's when they introduce you to the third Joker, the one that's supposed to be the boss.
Yeah.
The mastermind Joker.
This is the one that we kind of hinted at earlier that comes from the Brian Azzarello, mm-hmm. Lee Bermejo version, the one we would call maybe the gangster.
Yes.
He doesn't look like the Heath version, but he looks like the version in the book called it's just called Joker, right?
Yes. Yeah. Where he's kind of like, he's crazy, but not crazy, crazy. He's like,
it's more like the anarchist, like the, yeah, anarchist. The chaos crazy, like,
yeah. They're forming a plan, CM.
Yeah.
They want to make a new Joker to help carry on, to try to make the better Joker, you know? They form the plan, and then we get right back to the threesome of Jason Todd, Batman, Batgirl.
You could essentially say Batman, Robin, and Batgirl.
You could, yeah, Red Hood.
Oh, Robin, yeah.
Yeah. They head to the Gotham Aquarium where all the fishes are just poisoned.
Love this.
With the Joker stuff. You bring back an old ally of the Joker. You know, they have a big old scuffle. Jason Todd shoots the aquarium where this smiling shark just comes out.
And guys, huge shark smiling with his Joker grin.
Yeah. And then you got one of the Jokers. He pops out.
Yeah. That's right.
And he attacks him pretty hard. They beat him, though. It's pretty easy, though. They knock him out pretty quick.
Mm.
Jason Todd wants to kill him. You know, he wants to brutalize him. They tie him up to a chair. They start interrogating him. They want to know what the fuck's going on to him.
Yeah.
Three Jokers. Who are you? Are you the real one? Are you, you know, a fake number two, a fake number three? Yeah. Who are you?
Now, I want to interrupt you real quick, Double, only because I want to talk about how this Joker's dressed. He's kind of got on the pinstripe purple pants, mm-hmm. the spats, like the old, the old timey mm-hmm. spats, the purple gloves, and then kind of like the like a, just like a bow. It's not a bow tie, but it's like a like a ribbon, yeah. Type tie.
Like, almost like the one you're wearing.
Yeah. And it reminds me very much of like the old figure that we had when we were kids from the
Super Friends,
the Super Friends version. Right. Mm-hmm. That version. Yeah. The long chin, you know, it's very cool. Very cool looking. And then go ahead, Double A, tell me more.
So Joker is just talking shit to Jason Todd, getting into his head.
Oh, yeah.
Getting into Batgirl's head until finally he's had enough. You know, he kind of gives us some information that they don't say in depth in the family.
Mm-hmm.
So we're led to believe this is the one that brutalized Jason Todd.
Yes.
You know, he bashes his head. He tells him it wasn't even about him. He didn't even give a shit that he was bashing his head. It was just to make Batman pissed off. Like, he was just that pawn, you know? And for someone that's, you know, left for dead, that got their skull crushed,
mm-hmm.
just to hear that you're just a piece of shit. You didn't really care. You're just...
I killed you for no reason.
Batman. It was just to try and break Batman. Like, right. You're there.
It's almost like he's using the fact that he doesn't necessarily know that he hates Batman, but it's almost like he's playing on that without, like, you know.
So he's egging him on. Mm-hmm. Jason Todd has a gun pointed at
him. Yes, because Jason Todd, as Red Hood, carries a gun.
He's doing it more, and he's saying some stuff that Jason Todd doesn't want Barbara to hear.
Mm-hmm.
You know, Barbara's trying to tell him, put the gun down. And Joker, Sam, you know, you said some words that
I love this moment.
You know, I will always cherish.
This is what made me a Geoff Johns believer.
This is what Joker says, that when he was bashing his head, according to him.
Spoiler Jason alert, Todd, guys. Yeah, we should have said this beginning. Spoiler alert.
Jason Todd apparently said, please stop. Please, if you let me live, I'll do anything you say. I'll be your Robin. You know, and you're just like, oh, fuck. And he lets out a big old laugh. And he goes, and look at you now, my little Red Hood, shooting up people and making Batman's life miserable. You are my Robin. And he starts laughing.
Fuck.
Laughing. And Jason, that just breaks Jason Todd. And he shoots him in the head.
Bang. Fucking blows his fucking brain.
CM, what a revelation. Because,
right in front of Batgirl, guys. Batgirl's right there. Yeah.
But what a big revelation that, you know, we don't get in depth in the family. They just show him brutalizing him. And I was saying, CM, well, you know, it wouldn't make sense because Jason Todd was just a teenager.
Yeah.
He's dying. He's on the brink of death. Yeah. What would any teenager that's barely living say at that moment? You would, you know, you're being tied up, you're being tortured, you're being killed, you're going to be killed. And you would probably say something like that, no matter how well you're trained by Batman.
Yeah.
You're not Batman, you're Robin. Yeah. You're somebody else. You're never going to be that guy.
And you're scared.
You're going to die. Yeah.
You're with this insane maniac.
There's no negotiating.
Right. And this is a guy that maybe you fought before. Maybe this is a guy that has used jokes and gags and all that, and now he's just wailing on you with a fucking crowbar,
and you know you're gonna die,
and you know you're gonna die.
So what else are you supposed to say?
But damn though, right? Yes. Double A, because reading that, you're almost like, it almost strips away every heroic thing or
but
good
see
thing
him I felt like, so bad at this moment when I read this. I was like, holy shit, you really don't let yourself be put in those kind of moments, because certain writers don't do it, but when Geoff Johns wrote that incident, you can almost feel it being real. Yeah. You can feel it being scared. You can almost be imagine yourself, what would you be doing if you were tied up to a chair and this maniac was just wailing on you? We'd probably say the same thing. We'd probably say, please, please don't do this. And please let me live.
And then what's the flip of that, Double A? What's the flip of that? Now you went through that. But now you have the person that did it to you, vulnerable, a gun at their head. Most of us aren't going to think fucking twice.
No.
And you know what I love, too, is that the Joker is saying all this right in front of Barbara.
Yeah.
He knows.
Yeah.
He knows. His life doesn't matter to himself. He's pushing at the right possible time to push.
Yeah.
Here, let's take it away a little bit. Let's say it's not Batgirl. It's just a pretty girl there.
Yeah.
And you're telling her about the time you pissed your fucking pants in fear. You pissed on yourself. You were afraid. You cried like a little bitch. You cried. You begged me. Like, I'm just like, oh my God, this is fucking intense.
CM, I've read Death in the Family so much, and it wasn't until I read that line where I was like, it hit me even harder, probably more so than I've ever read Death in the Family, because I just can't imagine being that terrified.
It was so dark. That shit was so dark, man. I mean,
and then when Joker's like, look at you now, you're in a Red Hood, you're adopted by fucking identity. You're shooting people. You're making Batman's life miserable.
That line.
You became my Robin.
You already are my Robin. Yeah. You lived up to your name.
And then he just starts laughing. Fuck, you know, crazy. You're just like, it blew me away. That was intense.
That was intense. And you know what? We don't read a lot. Well, I don't read a lot. Me personally, a lot of DC. Maybe there was a moment where I thought, I was like, he's not going to do it, or Batman's going to show up, or Barbara's going to stop him, or whatever. Nope. Spoiler alert. Nope. He pushed all them buttons, and any normal person would feel the way you felt, and he pulls that fucking trigger.
Yeah.
And then that's one Joker.
One Joker down.
But so you don't
know. But you don't know if that's the real one or not.
Right.
You don't know.
He knew a lot, though, right?
That's what I'm saying. Was this the one that killed Jason Todd?
I don't know.
Were the other ones filled his head?
Right.
That the other two Jokers, whoever the real one, that he filled his head about what happened. How would he know those details, those intimate details?
Yeah.
You know, I don't know. It's just,
I mean, you can't.
Brutal.
Even if you were telling two other people that you wanted to, let's all share one identity, and you start talking about, okay, tell me everything that you know about yourself. It's like, how are you going to be like, hey, remember that time when I did this? You know what I mean? It's like, come on. You know what I mean? Like, unless going into it, somebody fills you in, but you don't know.
But to push the buttons like the way this one did, golly, and not even care, because you know he's gonna pull the trigger. It's almost like that Heath Ledger moment when he wants Batman to kill him, but then Batman saves his life, and he's like, oh, shit, you know, you did. Right. You didn't let me die, you know? It was like, golly. Like, Joker, for him, one of the Bat family to kill is a big victory for him. Now, obviously, Batman would be the biggest victory, but just to corrupt one of them is a major win for
him. Oh, yeah. You could even argue that it's a bigger victory because – you know, Batman does consider those others like his kids, you could say. And it's like, I corrupted an uncorruptible.
Yeah.
Although it was the low man on the totem pole, it was the weakest link.
But still, it was a Robin.
Right?
You know, he was under the tutelage of Batman.
You should have known better.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's still, he knows it's still a heart-wrenching blow, a fucking...
It is. It is
a huge shot to Batman. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there's that. But Double A, take us right into issue two.
Okay, so issue two, we kind of get like this weird thing. We see the classic, you know, the purple van.
Right. yeah.
You know, again, if you're alive in the 80s, 90s, you probably have that toy. He's coming home to his family. You know, the son is super scared. You know, he wants to have a family dinner, but then you just see it's on his mind.
It's not really happening.
Yeah. And the criminal mastermind Joker is like, what the hell are you doing?
Right.
You know, we have bigger things to worry about. Stop doing this. You know, and you kind of get like a little bit more information, just this little bit, with just the facial expressions that Jason Fabok does, you know, with this Joker, where he's like, you know, he's like, you know, he wants that family. It's weird.
Yeah.
Just that one little scene. You know, he gets really mad when this mastermind Joker touches the dummy that he believes is his wife. He's like, don't touch her, you know?
Right.
But this mastermind's trying to tell him, you know, there's only Batman. Batman is the only one that you should be focused on, you know? So, you know, you get more crime scenes. You know, skip to that. You know, the two Jokers talk. Obviously, the mastermind is not happy that the third Joker is dead.
Right.
So they're playing something else.
They fucked it up.
So we skip to another scene where Joker has done some damage. It was a corrupt judge that got turned, but he was corrupt. Batman doesn't really feel a whole lot of pity for him.
No.
Barbara kind of tells Batman what happened with Jason, you know?
Yeah.
And you can see the regret where she tells him Jason killed, but it's almost like Batman's like, he acts uncharacteristic of
Batman.
Being Batman and kind of just forgiving him.
Yeah.
Because he blames himself for what happened with Jason.
Yeah. And I think this is a huge element of this book, guys, because here you have a guy that is 100% against this, mm-hmm. against guns,
hates guns,
against that.
Always.
And now it's one of his crew, and he's stuck in a situation where
he's using guns. He's using violence.
Well, yeah.
He's killing.
Well, I mean, what can he do? Can he turn him in?
And that's the thing. He doesn't want to.
And not only does he not want to, but can he? Double A can't.
See, that's the thing. He feels so guilty about leaving him, about mm-hmm. not checking up on him mm-hmm. more.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he feels like he let Jason down.
Right. Yeah.
He feels responsible for him becoming the Red Hood.
Right.
He's taking on the full brunt, not right. Joker.
And I think he's even taking on this murder that happened, which is like against your base code.
Yeah, because even he goes like, well, it was one Joker. And Barbara even is like, it doesn't matter if it's one out of the three or anyone.
She's being the voice of reason. Yeah, she's like, it was a murder. Someone. It was a murder. Yeah,
and he shot him.
A incapacitated guy.
He was tied up.
Cold blood.
Yeah.
Yeah, he got pushed. He got pushed.
Yeah.
And he snapped. And it's like, that has to tell you so many other red flags.
And
like,
Batman is just giving her all of these kind of excuses.
Exactly.
And you can see
Barbara's
like, what the hell are you saying?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. But I mean, but ultimately, you know, we'll get to more on that. They're going to talk more about that. But go ahead, Double A. Take us to the next couple paces here.
Yeah. So you get Red Hood again, and he's brutalizing more people.
Right. Right. He's coping with his own whatever. Yeah,
Batman and Batgirl catch up to him. They're like, you know, we really got to put our resources together. We really got to, you know, find out, you know, what the hell is going on. He goes to Blackgate, you know, Arkham Asylum, you know, and you see all these all these bad guys. You see Rupert Thorne. You see Alexander Sartoris. You see Joe Chill. Joe Chill, obviously, is the one that killed his parents. Mm. He's not in there. Somehow he's gone. But Barbara tells him that he's in the hospital wing. He has stage 4 cancer.
Mm.
There's no way he could have done it, but because they find his fingerprint on one of the murders.
Yes, that's right.
And there's no way he could have done any of this because he's dying.
And I really like this aspect of this book too, Double A, is that, you know, they call Batman world's greatest detective, whatever, uh-huh. but there is something going on here too.
Yeah.
And so Batman is having to use those detective skills, which sometimes when I read Batman stuff, I feel like that's kind of missing, but I really like that it is.
Yeah, in this it did a really good job.
Yeah, yeah, very good.
Yeah, so he finds Joe Chill. Obviously, he's like, no, there's something wrong. There's no way this guy who's old, he's frail, mm-hmm. he's dying. There's no way he could have been at that crime scene. Someone is pulling him to this moment, to this guy. We flash forward to Jason Todd again. He's still doing his research. He's going to this warehouse?
Yeah,
almost like
I think
a pool.
So. Like an abandoned YMCA type.
Yeah,
thing.
And he sees this whole pool of chemicals, but with people
bodies in there
that are just bleached in this whole chemicals.
Yeah.
And they start attacking him. They start coming. And, you know, he's able to fend him off, but then the Joker grabs him. Fucking Joker again. He grabs him, the second Joker. And next thing you see, he's tied up again, but he's naked.
Naked, yeah.
And now getting the criminal mastermind Joker, the serious one. The one where it says it hurts when he laughs. You know, like he's not the crazy one like the other ones, mm-hmm. like the one Jason Todd killed, or the one, you know, that he was imagining he was having dinner with his family. This one is the more focused Joker, and he puts on the Red Hood again, And then that's when the second Joker comes. He's like, he's going to start wailing on him again. And he does. He wails on him with the crowbar all over again.
I think you want to just mention, though, that he puts the Red Hood helmet back on him.
Yeah. Yeah. So
he's not hitting him in the direct head, but the,
it's hard enough where it breaks.
Oh, yeah.
It breaks a lot.
He's smacking the fuck out of that helmet with the
crowbar. Because somehow they're thinking maybe they can turn Jason into a Joker.
Yeah.
But they're saying that, nope, you wouldn't make a good Joker at all. But maybe, just maybe, if we beat you close to death, you might die as a Red Hood, but wake up as a Joker.
Fuck.
You know, so it's like, golly.
Man, that's deep. That's
yeah,
fucking deep.
So it's like, golly, you already killed this dude, or think you have,
and then
you're doing it all over again.
Yeah, to the trauma of that, to recreate that trauma.
Yeah, but then they want you to be the perfect Joker.
Well, you know, they're truly breaking you down to that point.
Yeah. So then you get, you know, Batman, Batgirl, while that's going on, they finally get to where Jason's at. All those bodies seem to just pop up now.
Yeah.
They're all fucking super crazy.
Yeah.
One of them that attacks him, though, is laughing at, you know, tears are coming out and he's saying, like, help. Deep down, they can't really help themselves. You know, Batman, Batgirl, they're just, like, wailing on him.
Oh, yeah.
You know, they're getting rid of him, you know. They find Jason. He's in a pool of blood, naked. He's traumatized all over again. You know, Bruce tries to tell him, man, it's me. It's me. You know, and, you know, Jason snaps at Bruce finally. You know, he's like, why, you know, why'd you leave me there? Why'd you try finding me? Why'd you replace me with someone else?
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's just so much trauma that they all have to face. It's like, golly, the Joker fucking broke him again, all over again, right? See him, it's like, golly, he now Jason's kind of back to being broken again. He's like, why'd you leave me?
Yeah.
Why'd you just replace me with somebody else?
Yeah,
you
know, all that trauma is coming up.
It's coming back all over again.
And he's really only comforted by Barbara's touch. She puts her hands on him.
Barbara, like, knows what it's like.
Yeah, you know? Yeah. Well, plus, too, I think there's something to be said, AA, about it's a female and it's
it's a woman,
and it's comforting. Yeah, I mean, she's there, and she can, and plus, yeah, plus you damn near despise this other guy. It's almost like if your fucking dad betrayed you, like you feel like that. Like it's like
you turned
fucking big brother. They just turned your fucking back. I mean, you let me die. You let me get beat again and again. Let me get beat again. Yeah.
And then you replace me with some other fucking Robin.
Right,
you know?
Right. Like it's almost like, what's your fucking sick shit, dude? Like you're just like, you don't just put someone else.
You
know
what happened to me, and
suit.
Then you get somebody else.
Right, right. And so this is the second time he's been beat about his goddamn head too with a fucking crowbar by the same maniac that did it the first time. So his trauma is kind of understandable.
It's bad.
You know, I mean, but it's bad.
He passes out. They take him to Barbara's place. He wakes up. He sees Barbara's wheelchair. She still keeps it there. He sees the calendars where, you know, Jim, Commissioner Gordon, takes her to her therapy. She sees all these books. Obviously, she was fucked up too, Sam.
Yeah.
She has one for chronic pain, for forgiveness is freedom, aquatic exercise, therapeutic workout, every kind of thing to strengthen her mind.
She's trying.
Her body, trying to forget what the Joker did to her. They have this kind of moment, you know. Jason feels a lot for her. It's not really... it's not really like back on her part. It's more like she feels sorry for him. They kiss, but it's more like she kind of feels sorry for Jason more than anything.
I mean, I think she does relate, but he's somewhere else. His mental state is somewhere else. And I think that he thinks she's going to pull him out of this darkness.
Yeah.
Because he feels like he has no one but her, because she's been through exactly what you've been tormented by the same person, or we don't even know persons. You know?
Yeah, and they kind of show it too in issue 1 and 2, where the differences are, where he did a lot of harm to Barbara, but Barbara brought herself back.
Mm-hmm.
And Jason kind of, he came back, but he kind of went this other way. He kind of took a left turn to where he didn't do like Barbara. Barbara strained her mind, her body. She became at peace with herself, where Jason did not.
Yeah.
The last few issues of, you know, book two, you see Batman, and he's studying,
yeah,
like hard, the criminal, the clown, the comedian, trying to figure out who could it be? What Joker could it be? You finally see what happens to Joe Chill.
Mm-hmm.
Joker has him, and he's videotaping him. He asks, why did you really kill Thomas and Martha? Tell us.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just, golly, it's someone's brutal stuff.
It's dark, guys, and it's
very
getting
dark with a very lot, psychological
lot dark
bullshit.
And now we're going to move AA right as quick as we can through issue three, without giving you too much and not too little, because we want you to read this story. And obviously, we're giving you a bit, but we still want you to read it. And we're going to take you to kind of the main paces. But guys, let me tell you, every single panel is worth reading, and every single word is worth reading, and it is really excellent, guys. So AA, gear us up. As I like to say, brother, adrenalize me for this third act of the three Jokers with issue three.
Okay, so, you know, we get back, and again, Batman is, now we got Batman, we got Red Hood, we got Batgirl. They're studying intensely on this three Joker situation. You got a whole bunch of pictures on the table that Batman has put. You have, obviously, the comedian, the mastermind, the clown, but then you got, like, one that's called, like, the drifter, the babysitter, the judge, the zookeeper, the felon, you know, the inventor, the fisherman, the actor. You get so many. And
yeah, I think it's pretty much like a lot of the victims.
It's the victims. That. Yes, yes. They're all trying to make this perfect Joker. And Barbara's like, what the hell does that even mean, a better Joker?
Yeah.
You know, and
yeah,
they're just trying to figure it out. And, you know, Jason just keeps pushing Batman, you know, saying how, you know, if he would have just killed him, none of this would have ever happened.
Which he's also on his edge, because yeah, he knows that at this point Jason's killed in cold blood. Barbara's yeah, told him. Barbara's yes, like, what are you going to do about yeah, it? Like, what's up? Yeah. You know what I mean? And so Jason pushing at this time isn't the
he
good
says
time.
Batman was too weak to fucking do it. That's why he did it.
Yeah.
Batman just snaps. He's like, enough. You know, yeah, we tried helping you. You think if I would have known you were alive, I would have just left you there. You know, I would have done my best, but Jason's too hurt. He's like, yeah, but you didn't do it. You let this maniac kill me. You didn't even fucking lift a finger to do anything. You just sent him to jail, where he just came back out over and over and over again. And more people have died because you were just too weak to pick up a gun and blow this fucking dude's head off.
Mm-hmm.
Which, you know, goes against everything Batman stand for.
Right.
Guns were right, the reason why his parents got murdered, you know.
Yeah.
Batman just kind of loses it. You know, yeah, they have this big old kind of like little outburst.
Yeah, they go at it. I mean, you know, Jason tells him, you know, Red Hood tells him, you know, hey, if you would have just put a bullet in him, and then he's like, you think I didn't want to? You think I don't yeah, want to do that? You know what I mean? And Barbara has to kind of step in because they're already like at each other, and you know, she's like, just that's it. And, you know,
and so they kind of get back to their bearings, you know.
Right, right. They're going to work on the crime yes, together, you know. So it's.
Yeah. So they start analyzing, you know, the criminal. He's very focused. The clown, you know, he's lethal, but he has campiness.
Mm.
The comedian is dangerous. Something behind that laugh, there's something very sadistic about the right, comedian joke.
Right.
So they said, okay, we got to go. You know, we got to go figure this out, you know. Red Hood's finally in. He finally agrees, you know, okay, let's do it. Let's go get him. They meet. Bruce has, he goes back to Joe Chill's cell.
Mm-hmm.
That's
right.
They find out they took him. Somebody took Joe Chill. And Bruce finds all these letters written to Bruce Wayne. He's like, what the hell is all this? He's like, you better ask the priests around here. He wrote a whole bunch of them, but he never got around to signing any of them. You know, we see Jason. Him and Barbara kind of have like a little conversation. You know, he's saying, you know, what that kiss meant. Barbara's pretty much saying it didn't mean anything.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, she knows.
And Jason's kind of like, oh, you know, he really wants this relationship, but Barton's like, yeah.
I mean, yeah, I think he feels very close to her because of exactly what happened to them both. Yeah.
A very traumatic event happened to both of them, but she's very focused on her goals of what she wants to do.
Right.
Jason, you know, I don't think she can really feel like she can. He murdered. Even though it was a Joker, he still murdered someone. That goes against everything she stands against.
Exactly.
We get the next scene where Bruce, he talks to the priest. And, you know, he's like, yeah, you know, he tried writing these letters to Bruce Wayne, trying to feel remorse. And, you know, at first Batman's like, yeah, you know, it's always funny when they get sick, they always want to, you know, repentance. And,
sure.
And the priest is like, oh, he actually wrote this like a week after he got in, after he killed Martha and Thomas Wayne.
The Joe Chill character.
Yeah. And he's looking through these letters and he finds this one weird one that's not in Joe's writing.
And it's not to Bruce Wayne.
It's to Batman.
Batman.
And he opens it up and it's a ticket to the Mark of Zorro.
Yeah.
And it says what compliments and it has the Joker's face.
Yeah.
If you know anything, the Mark of Zorro is the movie where he goes see what his parents were. They got murdered.
That's right. It's very, very key.
It's very
in the know. You know what I mean?
Yeah. So Bruce rounds up Batgirl. He rounds up Red Hood. You know, there's this, you know, he goes to the old movie theater. One night only, the new Joker.
Yes. You know?
And there's no words. They drive. They all have this intense face. He tells her with the hand signal, go on top. He tells Red Hood, go over here.
Right.
He's going to go in the middle. They all have their own unique ways of getting in. And then that's when Joker very theatrically says, please take your seats, ladies and gentlemen. The show is about to begin. And he has a very scared, very sick, very dying Joe Chill right there on screen, asking him why he killed Thomas and Martha Wayne.
Even dressed almost in that.
And
Joe Chill, you know,
with the hat,
and the sweater.
So at the time that he's showing this to Batman, all these victims of the Jokers are attacking Barbara and Red Hood.
That's right. That's
going
right.
Crazy.
Yeah.
All right. So they're occupying Red Hood and Batgirl. The criminal mastermind Joker is the one that has Joe Chill. He's saying that Joe Chill is going to be their perfect Joker because he's done something to them that none of them could ever do. He's hurt Batman, you know.
And yes, he hurt him to the point of creating it.
Yes, and it kind of seems like this is the Joker, right? CM, you're thinking like this has to be the Joker, the criminal mastermind,
right?
At the same time, you know, Batgirl and Red Hood, they're doing good. They're wiping off the Joker victims.
Yeah,
when all of a sudden, one of the victims gets shot in the head, and at first she thinks it's Red Hood, and it's not. It's the Killing Joke Joker. And it's holy shit, you know. Now this Joker's come, you know. Obviously, this one means a lot to Batgirl.
Criminal she's kind of got her moment.
Yeah, Criminal Mastermind Joker. It has Joe Chill dangling over the vat of chemicals so he can be the new Joker. So that's what's going on over here. Batgirl gets a hold of the Killing Joke Joker. She beats him up. Batman is able to save Joe Chill. Everything looks like it's going to plan. Going to plan. And he saves Joe Chill.
And Batman's kind of forced to confront him and they're face to face.
Which is hard. So this is a guy that made Batman. He's the one that killed Thomas and Martha.
Mm-hmm.
He's looking to probably the most, the guy who probably hurt him the most out of any one of his criminals is this guy.
But Joe Chill does not know that Batman is Bruce Wayne.
No.
Although he knows he killed the Waynes.
But art on this, just feel Batman's pain, his conflict.
Because he has to kind of treat him like normal, like unbiased, you know?
Yes. And Joe Chill goes, you know, are you going to kill me? Batman says, no. You know, and he goes, thank you. And he kind of says very hesitantly, you're welcome.
Yeah.
You know? And then the criminal comes back and he's laughing hysterically. He's like, you know, I got you. You know, we're going to keep doing this game over and over. And then he gets shot in the head by the comedian Joker, the Killing Joke Joker.
Yes. in a moment that makes Batman's head kind of be like, what the hell? Like, what?
And then he drops the guns, yeah.
Yeah.
And he says, take me in. And he just starts laughing crazy, you know. And he gets taken away. Gordon comes in. And Batman rides with Joker. And that's when he tells him, see him? You know, he's like, the whole making Joker was stupid. You know, that was that other dude's Joker. You know, I'm the real one, or maybe I'm not. You know, and then he goes, so after all that drama, don't you feel better, Bruce? And you're like, holy shit. He called him by his name, see him? I think that's the first time I've ever heard.
I think so, too.
And you just this image of Batman drawn where he's not flinching, but he's like Bruce Wayne, Barbara Gordon, Jason Todd. He goes, you know, I know, but he names. I don't care. I won't tell. The world can never know your true name. You might stop doing this if you do. And Batman asks him, what do you want? He goes, what I want? He goes, I want to be in your head. I want to be the guy. I want to be your Joe Chill now. I want to be the one that pains you, the one you think of day and night. I want to be the only thought in your head. You know, that's all he wants. That's all he ever wants to do. And, you know, he's like, what's your game? And he's like, there is no game. This is just between me and you. We're going to keep doing this. He goes, the criminal was wrong. I am chaos. I am the devil. I am nothing to you and everything. It isn't the Joker that's broken. It was the Batman.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and he's just like, golly, you're just like, he doesn't care if the end. You know, he doesn't care about what happens to Batgirl, what happens to Bat, you know, Red Hood. He doesn't care what happens to Bruce Wayne, Alfred. He wants Batman. Batman is the one he's after.
You would almost say the only thing he does care about is Batman.
That's it. He doesn't care that this dude's a billionaire. He doesn't want his money.
No.
He doesn't want anything. He doesn't want... I don't know. It's just he wants Batman.
Yeah.
He wants him and Batman to do his dance for as long as they can.
Yeah.
He wants to break him like no other can. He wants to be the only thing in his fucking head.
I think he feels like he's found this mirror. And in this mirror is all the things that he could stand for. Not be. Because I think that the cape and cowl to him represents how I broke you and made you like me.
Mm-hmm.
I wear makeup and I wear this costume and, you know, or my skin is bleached, whatever. And I still, you know, put on clown makeup, whatever, and do this. And you're like me, you're broken, but you do something different. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you're trying to right the wrongs. Whereas me, I'm rolling with the punches, but we're both doing it in this extremist way. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And
his final words to him, CM, is I'll cut you. I'll hurt you. I'll keep twisting that knife until the day we both die together. And it's emphasized together.
Yeah.
I mean, it's fucking insane. That's all his whole goal is. That's what his whole, you know, end game is. It's just one day break this fucking guy.
Yeah.
You know, where he's going to kill him and Batman's not going to know. And Batman's just going to snap.
Yeah.
You know,
I don't even know if it's necessarily that maybe, I don't know if Joker wants to break him or he just wants the game to go on forever. He just wants to keep the game going on forever.
He wants the game to go on, but he wants to have it that end too where Batman kills him. That would be the end of the game for him.
Which would be him winning.
Yes. Yes.
So double round us out at the end here.
Yeah. So Bruce, after all this, he gets put away. He goes, visits Joe Chill, who's dying. And he tells him, he doesn't say it, but he holds his hand, pretty much saying he forgives him.
As Bruce Wayne.
As Bruce Wayne, and Joe Chill passes away.
Right.
All right, so I guess you can say he got a peace of mind before his death.
And we get the final, like, in a sense, death of Joe Chill.
Yes,
you know,
yes,
finally. If they're going to count this book as canon or whatever, we don't know yet. But
And then it goes to Alaska, see here?
Yeah.
Very cool. Bruce is driving. And
as Bruce Wayne again, not Batman anymore.
And he has flashbacks of him and Alfred talking. And, you know, he tells him, you know, oh, okay. Well, first off, there's this scene where Jason Todd kind of writes to Barbara.
Yes.
You know, he tells him, you know, if you can love me like I love you, I will give up being the Red Hood. You know, I would just be Jason.
He confesses.
Right? So. And he leaves a note taped to her door, but then it falls off. And then you got this weird guy kind of sweeping. He's dressed in purple. And the back of his suit says Funtime Cleaners, but his suit is purple. And you just see it swept away. And
you don't see his face or his head or anything. He's just got a guy's head down. That's all you get. Sweeping.
And so Barbara's never going to find this note from Jason ever.
Yeah.
Then you go back to Bruce and Alfred talking, and you know, he's like, Alfred's like, "Holy Master Bruce, you know, we're never gonna find out who this Joker is, really is." Bruce finally lets him in. He's like, "I've known the Joker's real name the first week after we met," which surprises the hell out of Alfred. So it turns out that his Joker is the Killing Joke Joker.
Yeah.
It flashes back to that moment where him and his wife, Joker and his wife, are having an argument. The Joker's wife knows he's fucking nuts. He's crazy. And she kind of goes to the police for protection.
Right.
They tell the Joker his wife and kid have died in electrocution. Joker goes apeshit. Later on in that Killing Joke, he snaps. This kind of snaps him. It's kind of like you said. It's almost in a way that Batman makes him.
Right.
You know, because of this. Batman knows who the Joker is and that his family is alive. And they're in Alaska. And Batman is seeing Joker's ex-wife or dead wife with their son. Joker has a fucking son, see him?
Yes.
In Alaska.
Yes.
Bruce looks. He sees them happy. He goes, "No one can ever know their Joker's name. If they do, they're going to find his family and they will never be safe." And he leaves them. And they're like in a very nice home in Alaska, a very warm home.
Right.
And that's when you find out, like, holy shit, the Joker has a family and they're in Alaska and it was the Killing Joke Joker.
I mean,
I was like, holy shit.
We're talking about what, 25 years ago, the Killing Joke came out? 30 years ago, it came out.
Yeah.
I mean, this long time, you know, which apparently, according to you, is what we're beginning to see is maybe a little bit of a hallmark of Geoff Johns is to kind of
connect stories.
Yes, connect stories, which is cool. These
older stories.
I wish he.
And he puts the holes, he fills the holes in these other ones.
I'll say this, I wish he could have tackled the whole Bishop gets a message from Jean Grey about the X-Mansion being attacked. Yeah. Maybe we would have got a different story than Onslaught.
Yeah.
But not to digress. I mean, yeah, what a great job, guys. And with the kind of the bare bones knowledge that I have, having read some of these books
Same here.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we're not in the deep, you know, we didn't know about the chair, all that. We just knew that, you know, some of these things are not picked up on. So, but excellent storytelling.
Yes.
Excellent. Art,
the writing, the art, the how deep it is,
the moments,
the psychology, put these stories, and they make it this one complete story. So great. I enjoyed this story so much. I actually tweeted to the artist, you know, I thought it was one of the best Joker stories ever.
Yeah, easily.
He liked our tweet.
Nice. You know, awesome, so, man.
Great. Yeah, I thoroughly enjoyed this story. Of the Joker.
Now, Dylan, before we get out of here, and I'm going to force a little bit of final thoughts on you, tell me what you think about Batman in the situations that they're in. I mean, here he's got these, like, I mean, we could say kind of kids. Maybe they're 10 years younger than him, maybe a little bit more. But it's like we were kind of talking about this earlier before we got started about how Batman, you know, he trains this Robin. And he doesn't want Robin to get hurt.
Mm-hmm.
So he doesn't want Robin to go on any of the bad missions, quote unquote. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? But Robin sees it as like, you know, you've been training me my whole life and now you want to leave me on the sidelines.
Yeah.
It's like, no, I'm your best asset. And it seems like a trend, you know, with Batman training people up, almost in a sense, I think the way he thinks is like, in the event that I die, someone can pick
someone up the mantle. Someone will take the mantle,
You know?
Okay.
But at the same time, he's still human and he doesn't want them to die. He doesn't want to just sacrifice them. Mm-mm. So he's like, if I can save you, then I will, you know, but he doesn't let them get out of their they can never be as good as they could be because he's like always like, in a sense, holding them back. You know what I mean? It's don't go on this mission. You might get killed.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but you're supposed to have trained me to be ready for anything. How do I know? You're holding me back from the most dangerous shit, which I get. It's almost like a father figure thing. It's like a protection of the family. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, they're viewing it as just like, what the fuck are we training for then? Like, what the fuck are we supposed to be like the next best to you for then? We don't and never going to know because you're always trying to like cover us with your cape. You know what I mean? Yeah. So, I mean, I just think this book really helped me see the interesting dynamic of that.
It did.
Through the Red Hood's eyes, through Barbara's eyes, as Batgirl.
Yes.
And it's just like, it's not always going to be, you know.
What's cool, too, is they show how, you know, the traumatic events that happened between Batgirl and Red Hood, but how they each reacted in a different way. Barbara kind of made herself stronger mentally, physically. Jason, you know, it fucked him up mentally. It made him probably more focused fighter, probably more, you know, more like Batman, but it left him broken.
Yeah.
It was a very cool dynamic to see how he trusted Batgirl more than he trusted Jason.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And how he was hoping that he would have ended up like her.
There's a moment, I think it's in book two or three, where he says it. He's like, don't you see Barbara, like how manipulative he is? Like, this is what he does or whatever, you know what I mean? And it does make you wonder, you know what I mean? Like we often say, we've said in previous episodes, like, you know, I feel like DC kind of puts Batman on this huge pedestal or whatever. I'm not saying he doesn't deserve it. He does.
Yeah.
But at the same time, it's like, here's a guy that's very flawed,
very
damaged. Yeah. He's contradictory. He's putting them, you know, I mean, I've talked about it before and you know, we talk about Batman the Animated Series, which I love that Bruce Wayne. I love that Batman. Mm-hmm. But there's when he goes after Clayface and he goes after Mr. Freeze, I'm like, you know what? You're not right right now. Yeah. There's no righteousness here because this is exactly what you do. When you put on the cape and cowl, you're trying to defend against, you know, you're raging against the machine that is what happened to me. I'm not going to happen to anybody else. You're allowing yourself your own form of revenge, but you're denying others.
Yeah,
you
know, but
there's
I think
a lot of hypocrisy there.
It is a hypocrisy, but it's also kind of wanting to protect one's own kids.
Sure.
He sees them as his kids.
No, yeah.
He took them in. They were orphans, bad orphans, you know, that were, you know, families got murdered.
Right.
You know, gave away. He's trying to protect them as much as he could, but he's trying to give them purpose as well. You know, something, you know, we don't use guns. You know, we don't kill people.
Right.
We arrest bad people, take them off the street so they won't hurt people like they did with us.
Yes.
You know, Batman got his parents. He became an orphan.
Yeah.
He can identify with Jason, with Dick Grayson, with Tim Drake. You know, he's rich, but he's an orphan as well. He lost his parents.
No, you know? For sure.
He just wants to bring out the best in them, but he wants to protect them at the same time.
Yeah.
I don't think that's a bad thing.
No, I think that's any parent. It's any parent. But it's an interesting dynamic how it plays out.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Because, like, you know, I think a lot of parents, even though they know it's a noble and good cause, don't want their kids to go off to the military because they could get killed.
Yeah,
Nobody wants that. Yeah. Nobody wants that. But that may be something for the person that makes them feel worth and value in their life. You know what I mean? And I think that's what the Bat family is. It's like,
it is.
Barbara wants to do her part. You know, Dick wants to do his part.
Yeah, and you know what, Barbara, too, you know, it's like her dad's a commissioner.
Right.
But her mentor is like Batman. So it's just like, golly, I really got to step up, you know?
Yeah.
To this ideal, you know?
Seriously. No, I get it, man. Let's just talk. I just want to hear that final thoughts. Yeah, but we're getting there. What do you think about Three Jokers, AA? I mean, obviously, I think you love it, but, you know, highlights, low points, what do you feel good, bad, and different, the Three Jokers?
I just thought it was a really good story. It's so much from the past that they bring to the forefront. It's so deep, like I said, you know, the emotion that, you know, when they finally come to blows with each other, Red Hood and Batman, you know, we're just all that anger, all that buildup anger towards them. You know, the Three Jokers, I thought it was a stupid concept until I read it. The Joker probably would do something like that. Probably might try to make someone else a Joker, you know, just for the fun of it. You know, I love how he knows who Bruce is.
Yes.
Like, he knows all of them. He doesn't care. You know, he just wants to fuck them up.
Yeah.
He wants to do this dance all the time.
Yes. That's his thing. That's his thing.
I thought it was good. I couldn't really find too much low points. I
agree.
I like the whole story. So I thought it was a really good story. One of the best Joker stories. And I probably would put this up there with Death in the Family, with Joker, with Killing Joke. Yeah. Nice. Yeah. It's actually a really good sequel to those books, actually.
It is. Yeah. You love how it brings those elements in. Yeah. You're almost like, oh, it's like, I do know this.
Yeah.
You know, so I definitely feel the same way. Very pleasantly surprised. Didn't really know what to expect. I think this might be my first Geoff Johns story.
Oh, okay.
So, I mean, there was that. Excellent writing, art, beyond gorgeous. I can't wait to share these covers with you guys over the week as we do our promoting for this episode. But, I mean, yeah, I would say highly recommend.
Yeah, yeah.
Great story, great action, yeah. Great, a classic Batman tale. Mm-hmm. And again, an insight into who the Joker is, but also who Batman is.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Why do you keep doing this? Why do you keep creating these wards that could potentially get
killed?
You know what I mean? Like, all you're doing is, you know, going to love them, and then you're going to be heartbroken since something happened. You know, yeah. Like, and now we know he's been through it. So it's like, yes, he's been through it, you know. And again, guys, this is printed under DC's Black Label. Me and AA aren't too familiar with what that specifically means. Is the Black Label something separate? Is it like Marvel Max, where it's like separate from the rest, or is it considered canon? I don't know. You know what I mean? But just masterful storytelling.
Yeah.
Really masterful. I mean, for three issues, you get so much.
Yeah, you do.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It doesn't slow down, and you're just like page turning.
Yeah.
I just can't wait to get to the next one, you know?
Yeah.
So, I mean, I thought it was awesome, man. Yeah. That was awesome.
Same here.
I want to know this before we go also. So do you think there was always three Jokers?
Yeah. Yeah.
So from the very, so who was the original Joker?
See, that's the thing. I don't know.
See, I know.
Because there's a part in, I want to say, book three, where the mastermind, the one that's more focused, claims that him and Batman have been doing this dance for a long time. So I was like...
So does that lend you back to the Bob Kane creation?
Yeah.
So I was like... So and he kind of looks most like that one.
Yeah, and so I was kind of like, shit, so maybe that's the real one. And this art, you know, the Phil comedian just took up the mantle. I mean, I want to say maybe it was the mastermind that was probably the real Joker.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
That's interesting to me. So I wonder too. I'm not really sure yet.
He's the one that knew all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
I was like,
It does make you wonder. I also find it interesting that, you know, since obviously Heath Ledger has passed away, whatever, but we have, I think, three Jokers right now. We still have Jack Nicholson, Jared Leto, and Joaquin Phoenix. It's like, you know, and they're all three Oscar winners. Yeah. So it's like, essentially, right now, we live among three Jokers in a sense, you know? So just like I said, really, really great story. I didn't know what to expect, but I was really pleasantly surprised. I enjoyed it. I enjoyed the art immensely. I enjoyed the covers immensely. Super awesome, man.
Yeah, super awesome. Same here.
Anything else that you think that may have missed?
No.
Well, guys, I mean, that, I think, probably does it. Am I right? AA? Yeah. The three, Batman, The Three Jokers by Geoff Johns, printed under the DC Black Label. You could probably go, I definitely could probably go to Gravity Damage and pick up all three right now, in one form or another. They did a great second printing cover of issue one, where he's got a shark hand, which is neat because of the shark in that issue. But guys, go pick it up.
Yeah.
Don't wait. Don't hesitate. You like the Joker. You like Batman. Issues. Yeah, it's a great Batman story. I'm sure they're going to collect it one day and be beautiful, but don't wait, man. Go get it right now. You can get the original issues and just enjoy them. I mean, it's a really fucking cool story. Mm-hmm. It had me and AA talking about, like, if something did happen to Bruce Wayne, Batman, what would be the ascension of the Bat family? Correct me if I'm wrong, or disagree with me if I'm wrong, AA, but we said Dick Grayson, who is currently Nightwing, would become
the mantle.
Batman. Mm-hmm. And I would personally see
Tim Drake, right?
I would see him become almost like the
Nightwing. Yes.
Him take over that mantle. And then you've got Damian. Well, Damian is so on edge and so kind of a wild card. Damian Wayne, who, guys, if y'all didn't know this, the son of Bruce Wayne, almost becoming like a Red Hood-esque mm-hmm. character, which leaves us to say, well, what does the Red Hood become? And I mean, Joker. this book proved that he could become the Joker. He's broken yeah. like that, and he's a killer like that. Yeah. So I don't know. It's very interesting. It's very interesting. Yeah. I would like to know everyone out there that read this book, your thoughts. You know, tell us, let us yeah. know. You know, hit us up.
Yeah.
But guys, we got to go. We got to get back to the Batcave, check in with Alfred, get our wounds healed, and refill our mugs here. Yes. Anything else before we go?
No, man. No, just be safe out there and have a good Friday.
Yeah, same here, guys. Same here. Guys, what I always like to say before we get going, we live by a creed, too, much like Batman's no kill code. And ours is, guys, if you have an opportunity to do something, change a life, make a difference, create something, do it. Seize the day. Today is the day. The moment is now. The minute you hear this and you thought about it, go do it. Go live that dream. And guys, sometimes there's going to be challenges, obstacles that get in your way. The only way that you can overcome them is to do whatever it takes. Guys, for myself, CM Chuck, and my co-host here,
Double A,
Adamantium Adam, guys, this has been another episode of Just Another Friday Night, all about the three Jokers.